Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about advanced control structures and I want to introduce procedures, so basic procedures. Let's get started. So in a previous video, you have seen already the basic control structures, consisting of the skip command that does nothing, the print command that prints the value evaluated in the current state of an expression, the assignment of a variable, the assignment of a variable that a new value is assigned to a variable, a sequential composition, conditional, and the while loop. So there are more control structures than these, and the control structures not listed here I want to discuss in this video. So let's look at them. Which other control structures can you imagine? Maybe you have already seen some in some certain programming languages. Well, we have the notion of a code block, and we have the notion of an early exit. You can also label commands, and then using those labels, you can do jumps. And there are also ways to do computed jumps, and for those you use switch commands. In this video I will talk about the introduction of locals, local variables, and those are needed for explaining procedures. Whenever you have procedures, you also have returns from procedures. And that is all the advanced control structures that are now coming. There are more control structures, but they will not be part of this video. So a code block, you can understand it as a way of grouping commands together. So you have already seen the code blocks before, in the body of the if command and the while command. But you can also introduce these blocks standing on themselves. And then it allows you to introduce code blocks in arbitrary places. So to give you an example, there are different syntaxes for code blocks. And in a Pascal-like language, or Algol-like language, you use begin and end. But the widely known way of introducing code blocks is in C-like languages using curly braces. However, there are also programming languages that indicate code blocks using whitespace indentation only. The example of that would be Python. Now, you could ask yourself, what is the purpose of a code block? Why would you have to use them? Well, and the answer is actually quite simple. It is to disambiguate the grammar of commands. And just like you have parentheses in expressions for grouping certain sub-expressions, you can use the code blocks for grouping together commands. Now, to give you a clear example where that can happen, consider the updated grammar as shown now. So previously we had the curly braces around the body of the if and while, but now these are just single commands, and in general we now have the code block construct. So you can then ask yourself, given the following command, what is its meaning? Now, the grammar is ambiguous, because do we interpret this semicolon, this sequential composition construct, by grouping together these two statements, these two commands, and place them under the if? Or do we consider the if and then the assignment x by 5 to be the body of the if, and that whole command to be sequentially composed with the assignment of 5 to y? So that is now the question. And depending on the programming language, there are different rules of precedence also there, and also rules for associating. Well, in this case, we have only one binary operator on the commands, namely the sequential composition. But now think about sequential composition. Does it now associate to the left or does it associate to the right? And if you consider, for instance, some commands A, B, and C, it stands for an arbitrary command, then what is the meaning of A sequentially composed, B sequentially composed, C? Well, we could group it by first saying we group A and B together, and that is then composed with C, or we could group it otherwise, namely first A and then B and C. Now, in most cases, these result in the same behavior, but as we shall see in later videos, the grouping construct, the code block, is also used to add variable declarations. And as soon as you do that, then it of course makes a difference how you perform the grouping. But that topic will come back later. Oh, and by the way, if you want to know how, for instance, the precedence rules are, it is better to just write down code which is unambiguous, to avoid any confusion. But in the case where you have an if with immediately a command followed afterwards, you can of course understand only the next command to be falling under the if. So in an ambiguous case like this, we interpret it grouped as follows. So that the assignment of x by 5 falls under the if, so that is the if body, and the assignment that follows it follows the whole if, and it falls outside of the if body. And the same thing applies for the while. So that means if and while precede sequential composition. Okay, let's look at another advanced control structure. That is breaking and continuing. Now, breaking, it means breaking out of a loop. So you can imagine having a program in which in some loop, instead of continuing the execution until the end of the loop body, you want to exit early out of the loop body. Well, you can exit early by issuing the break command. So here is an example. Here you see a while command, and the body here is indicated by the code block. In the body, we have these two assignments, and then a conditional. If this expression turns out to be true, we want to break out of the loop. So the point of the break statement is that it looks at the nearest enclosing while loop. So this break will break out of this while loop because that's the nearest enclosing while loop. And most programming languages consider it a syntax error if you have a break command and there is no enclosing while loop surrounding it. So before I continue with the continue command, what does the break do? As soon as the break command is executed, it looks at the nearest enclosing while block, while command, and then it basically moves the control point to after the while. The break command no longer evaluates the test of the while. It immediately breaks out of the while. So it is possible to break out of a while at the same time the test is still positive. This makes it a bit more complicated to analyze. If you do not have a break inside a while body, then whenever you exit the loop, you know that the test was false. But as soon as you make use of the break command, this no longer is necessarily the case. And in this example, you could, for instance, see it. For instance, take for x 0. Well, 0 obviously is smaller than 100. And take for y maybe 7. Then 0 times 7 is 0, so x stays 0. And then we increase y by 1, so y becomes 8. And then 8 divided by 4 equals 2. And then we break out of the loop. So then we are now after the while command, but it is still the case that x is smaller than 100. Okay, so that is something to be careful about. So let's continue with the continue command. What does the continue command do? Well, in a loop body, if you issue the continue command, we do not break out of the loop. No, we immediately jump back to the start of the loop. And we then evaluate the test as if we have reached the end of the while body. So here is an example. Here we have a while command and the test x smaller than 100. And inside of the body of the while, you see here the continue. So now suppose that we start at the loop, x, let's say, 0, and let's say y initially is 1. Well, then we enter the while body. Y is now increased by 1, so it becomes 2. And now we test whether y is even. Well, 2 is even. This is, by the way, the modulus operator. So it basically is the remainder after division. So if you divide 2 by 2, the remainder is 0. Well, so this test is true. So we then enter the if body, which is the continue command. And the continue then, just like the break, looks for the nearest enclosing while. And that is in this case this while command. And then we immediately jump to the control point, where we then again evaluate the test. And when the test then is true, we enter the body of the while again. But if the test is false, then we go to the end of the while statement, so to the, sorry, of the while command, to the next. So it is, if you have a while body that consists of a continue, then it is the case that if you exit the loop, then it must be the case. If there is not a break state, the break command, sorry. Yeah, I keep confusing the word command and statement, but the reason why is because they're often used interchangeably. but if you have this continue command here, then we must always jump back to the beginning of the loop. So the only way to exit the loop would be if the test was false. Then you can exit the loop. So whenever you reach the end of the loop, so the control point reaches the command following the while, then it must be the case that the test is negative. Okay. Let's consider now labels. Some programming languages, imperative programming languages especially, allow you to give a name to a particular command. So how does that then look like? Here you have an example. Suppose we have two whiles. One is nested in the other. So this while is part of the body of the outer while, as it is called. And now we can label the commands by giving it a name. And in this case, I just give a name and then a colon. Now, these names, they indicate a control point. So a position in which the execution of the program could be. So in this case, we give the while command here the name A. And we give this assignment, which increases y by 1, the name B. Now, labels do not affect the execution of the program whenever you just insert them, right? The labels are not significant yet for the execution of the program. So you could ask yourself, well, then what is the purpose of having these labels in the first place? Well, you can imagine, of course, adding new commands to our programming language, which makes use of these labels. And the reason we want to do that is to direct control flow in a more specific manner. Now, to give you a concrete example of the usage of labels, consider what is called a multi-level break and continue. In the previous example, you have seen a nested while loop. So that means we have an outer while loop and we have an inner while loop. But what if you now want to break? As I explained before, the break is a breaking free out of the loop that is the nearest and closing loop. But what if you want to break out of a loop that is on the outside? So here you have an example. Again, we have a while, and then nested in the outer while, we have an inner while. And then in the body of the inner while, we have an if. And in the body of the if, we have a break. But the break now includes a label, in this case, outer. So then this break does not refer to the nearest and closing while. No, it refers to the while that is labeled by the name outer. So this break refers to the outer while. And that allows you then to escape not only the while in the body, but also the outer while. So this break outer will break from this while and from this while. So the next control point after executing the break command would be the command that follows the outer while. So then we end up at this position here. And just like break, you could also use continues with a label if you want to continue an outer loop. Now, there is also a more advanced use of labels, but it's a bit tricky. And this is the goTo command. The goTo command allows you to jump to an arbitrary label in your program. So you could imagine, I give you an example, where there are multiple labels. For instance, this label B is a label of this outer block. This C is a label of, well, in this case, it doesn't say a command after it, but you can imagine that this is a label of the control point after this block that is named by B. And then we also have a label A for this if, a command here. Okay, so let's have a look at what the program now specifies. So we have a block, that's this block here, and then the first command in the block is this if, and then the body of the if is this goTo C. So you could imagine that we execute, so we start at the beginning, and then we enter the block, and then we evaluate the test, and suppose that the test is then true. Well, then we execute the goTo command, and the goTo then transfers us, transfers the control to the one, the command indicated by C, which is after the block. Right? And so then immediately the program ends because there is no longer a command here to execute. So this goTo C brings you to this position over here. Well, now suppose that the test of the if was false. Well, then we continue. So then we end up with this if. And in this case, we see a test, x smaller than 5, okay. Suppose that's the case, well, then we can enter the if body, enclosed by these braces, so that is then this grouping construct, the code block here. So then we continue with this command here, and after the execution of this command, we see a goTo A. Hey, but the goTo A then jumps control back to this point. And we have to again evaluate the if test. So you can imagine that the execution proceeds like this. As long as this test is true, we execute the body and we go back to the test. So this is almost the same as a while loop. So while x smaller than 5, we execute this. And then we go back to the beginning, and then we evaluate the test again. So, moreover, whenever this test is false, just like the usual if, we continue with the next command, that is this assignment here. And then we can see that there is a command go to B. But go to B goes back to the beginning. As you can imagine, using go to's quickly can make this control flow a very difficult thing to analyze. And that even has a technical term. If you litter your program with lots of go-tos, it becomes more difficult for you to understand how the control flow, how the control point moves over time. And you could even argue that this is the main motivation for using these structured commands, the ifs and the whiles. Using go-to makes the program way more difficult to analyze and to understand. Because it is no longer the case that if you look at the particular command, that you can understand when that command is executed, if there are lots of go-tos that may jump from one place to the other place. You can no longer easily see from the text of your program how each command corresponds to a position in the execution. Because remember from the previous video, in a structured program, a particular position in the text, control point, plus if you know how often all the enclosing whiles were taken, gives you a point in the execution. But this is no longer the case if you have go-tos everywhere, because now you have to trace from the beginning all the possible ways that you could end up at a particular command. So this is also called the technical term for these programs that are difficult to understand is also spaghetti code, because the control flow looks a little bit like a bowl of spaghetti. It's a big mess of how control flows from one point to another. Okay, so there are other downsides to go to, and that is why most programming languages have abolished the use of go-to, and I will explain that later. Now, there is a special kind of go-to, which is the switch command, because you could imagine that these labels A, B, C that you have given names, that you want to sometimes compute based on a value at runtime to which label you want to jump. And this is what the switch command does. So here is a concrete example to explain to you a bit how it works. So say we here have a switch and then we have a code block. And then we have special labels, namely case labels, and they take a constant value. In this case, it's the value 1, 2, and 3. And there is a special kind of label, it's the default label. Now, depending on the value, as soon as we start executing the switch command, we evaluate whatever value this expression has, and that value then is used to jump to one of the case labels. So suppose y is 1, then we jump to this command here. Suppose y is 2, then we jump to this command here. Suppose y is 3, then we jump to this command here. And suppose y has any other value, then we jump to what the default label indicates. So that is the command over here. Now, there is something special, in some programming languages at least, that this is called fall through cases. So these break commands are used to break out not of a while, but out of the switch command. So here we have the body of the switch, and now the break breaks out of the switch. So this break makes sure that the next control point to execute is whatever follows the switch command. And so whenever say y is 1, then we jump to this assignment here, say it's setting x to 5. And then executing the next command, which is a break, causes us to jump out of the switch. But a fall through case is the case 2. So suppose y has the value 2, then we jump to this part of the program. And this is the control point then. We perform the assignment x becomes 10. But then we, of course, because sequential composition indicates that, simply continue with the next command, which is in this case performing an addition of 5 to the value of x. And only then we break out of the switch. So what happens here is that the control basically falls through the case. So the case, whenever case 2 is finished with execution, so that is this command here, then it simply continues with the next command, which has the label case 3. Although the value of y was simply still 2. Okay, so this phenomenon is called fall through cases. Not all languages have them. For instance, Go has no fall through cases. There, every case is as if it has a break command after each command indicated by a case label. Now, there is also a nice construct, but I won't go into the details here. But if you want to study that yourself, it's quite interesting. It's called Duff's device. It's a way of combining switch with inside the body of the switch, then a while loop. And then inside the while loop, certain commands in the body of the nested while loop are then given case labels. So if you follow this link, then you will read more about that piece of program. And also there, not all programming languages support this. For instance, the Java programming language does not allow you to put a while inside the body of a switch. But the C programming language does allow you. Okay, so let's continue with the next advanced control structure, which is the local command. And the local command can be used to temporarily store the value of a particular variable. To temporarily store the value of a variable that is then restored after a block has executed. So to give you an example program in which you can see how that works, here you have an example program. Let's execute it. So we start at the beginning, we assign 10 to the variable x, and then we execute the local command. And the local command consists of an assignment and then a block. In this case, this is this whole block here. Now, what does the local do? It, in some space in memory, stores the original value of the variable x in this case. And then it performs the assignment x becomes 5. So in this execution, we knew that x had the value 10 before executing the local command. So now somewhere in a temporary storage, the old value of x is stored. And then x is assigned the value 5. And we enter a block. And in the block, we perform first a print. And well, what is the value of x? Well, we just performed an assignment. So in this, at this point in the execution, x has the value 5. Then we continue and we change the value of x to become 15. And then we can print x again. Well, now it has, of course, the value 15. But once we exit the block, that temporary value that was stored is now restored in the variable x. So the original value of x before executing the local command is restored after the local command is done executing. So at this point, after the local command, whenever we print x, what would be then the value of x? Well, it is the original value before we started executing local, which at that point was 10. So that value is restored. So whenever we print x, we then print the value that x currently has, and that is the result of restoring it. So that is 10. And so this print command prints the value 10. Now, why is it useful to have this temporary storage? Well, that I will explain later when we introduce procedures, because sometimes you want to use the same variable name, but in different contexts during your execution. So in that case, it is useful to be able to temporarily store the old value, then work with the variable with some new value, and then restore the old value back. And in implementations of programming languages, this is typically called a stack. So we have a stack where we can temporarily store the value of variables. And then later on, whenever we want to restore, we pop the value that was temporarily stored on the stack and are then able to find back the original value that it used to have. Okay, so you can now also ask yourself the critical question, if we have these local commands, what could then go wrong whenever we combine this with goto's? So suppose that we have a goto command inside the local block that jumps outside of the local block. So suppose, for instance, somewhere within the body of the local, there is a goto that jumps out. Then it could potentially mean that the value is not restored. And this could maybe make the program go wrong. So it is complicated to combine jumps, like goto, with locals. Another reason to abolish the use of goto. To make sure that it is easy to implement these temporary storage of the value of variables. Now, of course, you could imagine analyzing whether whenever a goto happens with a particular label, if that label escapes one of the local blocks that surrounds the goto towards its goal, that then the value of the local, the local variable has to be restored its original value before you perform the jump. But of course that can be implemented. That makes the implementation of a programming language more complicated. Okay, so now as a final advanced control structure, let's consider procedures. So the use of procedures can best be understood from analyzing a piece of text and recognizing that the same sequence of commands appears at multiple places in your program. And what if we could then factor out the reoccurrences of the same commands and just name them by some name? Well, and for this, the facility of procedures is used. And you can declare a procedure by giving it a name and then associating it to a sequence of commands. And then whenever you then want to invoke the sequence of commands associated to the procedure name, this is then called calling the procedure, performing a procedure call. So this necessitates your programming language to have procedure declarations. And it depends on the programming language how this works. But most typically you declare the procedures beforehand. And then whenever you have a sequence of commands, you can then make use of the name that you have declared before. But in other programming languages, it is not necessary that you declare a procedure before you can call it, that you can mix the order around. A procedure call, the semantics of a procedure call is actually quite interesting. So I told you about this stack of temporary values. Well, how can you understand a procedure call? Well, it depends, of course, on the context where you call the procedure, of where to return after the procedure has finished. So, but how do you know where to return to? So what you can imagine is that in the implementation of a procedure call, the control point that follows the procedure call is temporarily stored on the stack. And then after the procedure, the execution of the procedure ends, then you can look at this value stored temporarily being a control point and simply jump back to where you originally were in the program. I will explain that later with the example. So this returning is an interesting phenomenon that happens after the procedure has executed. Well, you can also imagine that why would you do it only at the end? Can you not have something like an early exit like we had with the break command? Yes, that's also possible. You can also have an early exit out of a procedure call, and that is also called returning. Okay, so let's consider an example. So here you have a procedure declaration, and let's give this procedure the name P. And it's also called the body of the procedure, and that is the command that is given here. So we declare the procedure with name P to have the body if x smaller than 5, and then the body of the if is the assignment of x by x plus 1. So this is a procedure declaration. It on itself does nothing, right? You cannot execute a procedure declaration. You can only execute commands. So then we need to have a command. In this case, we have this sequence of commands. And then during the execution of a command, we could at some point encounter a procedure call. And in this case, by just naming the name, by just putting the name of the procedure, you indicate the call of a procedure. Different programming languages have different syntax, but most of them use something similar as this. So by just giving the name of the procedure, you then perform a procedure call. So what happens in the case of this program? Well, let's suppose we start with an arbitrary value of x, maybe larger than 10. So let's say we start with x 11. Okay. X is 11, so the test is true and we enter the body. So then we decrease x by 2, and so then x becomes 9. And then we perform a procedure call. So, okay, the procedure must be called, but we also need to know where to return after the procedure has completed. So we, on the stack, store the next control point after the procedure, which is in this case the end of the while body. And then we transfer control to the body of the procedure. So, well, x is 9, so x smaller than 5 is false, and we exit the if command, and we reach the end of the body of the procedure. Whenever you reach the end of the body of the procedure, you then can look up this temporary value, which indicates the control point where to return to. Well, and that was, in this case, the end of the while. So our control returns to after the command that follows the procedure call, in this case, the end of the while. And if you reach the end of the while body, you jump back to the beginning, and you loop back to the beginning of the while. Well, x is still 9, but this time the test is false, so we exit. We continue with the command that follows the whole while. So then we end up here with the next while loop. Well, x was 9, and here we have a test that says x smaller than 0. Well, that's false, so we end the program. Now, I want to make clear to you that it is important to temporarily store where the control point, what the control point is after a procedure has been called. Because as you can see from the program, there are multiple so-called call sites. These are occurrences of the name of a procedure inside the program. So we had to store somehow the control point that we want to return to, because from the text of the program, it's not obvious where we should return to. Should we return after this call site, or should we return after this call site? Now, and by storing the control point temporarily, it enables us, after executing the procedure P, the body of the procedure P, then we know where we should continue. And this storage, this temporary storage, that consists of the control points where to return to, this is also typically called a call stack. And now, this might be confusing, because I previously talked about a stack of temporary values for locals, local variables, where you could store temporarily the values of locals. And now I'm talking about a call stack, where control points are temporarily stored. And in most implementations of programming languages, these two are often combined into one structure, data structure, which is then simply called the stack. So both the control points and temporary values for variables are both stored in a data structure called the stack. But different programming languages may, of course, implement it in different ways so that you can separate out the call stack and the temporary variable stack. Okay, let's consider more advanced procedures. Because this call stack is interesting, but where becomes it really clear that you need a call stack? Well, that is the case whenever you make use of recursive procedures. A recursive procedure is a procedure in which, in the body of it, a call to itself occurs, and that it's called directly recursive. You could also have indirect recursive procedures, where in the body of a procedure there is a call to another procedure, and in that other procedure's body there is a call back to this procedure that we started with. So that is an indirect recursive procedure. Well, here you have an example of a directly recursive procedure, because in the body of procedure with the name P, you see a call to P. Well, and now it becomes clear that this call stack, in which you keep track of the control points where to return to after a procedure has been called, is important. Because whenever you have a recursive procedure, in this case, suppose that the procedure P is called, well, then we execute the body, and now suppose that P is called again, then whenever we return, we want to return from the latest invocation or the latest call to P. And that was the most recent call to P. And so that is why we need a stack data structure, so that we can keep track of what was the latest call to P. And that is the one that you would want to return from or to. Now, each time you, as it is called, invoke a procedure, or whenever you want to call a procedure, the implementation of your programming language, so that actually performs the execution of your program, it keeps track of all the procedure calls and all the information that is required. And this is called an activation record, a procedure activation record. And the procedure activation record includes the return control point, that you want to return control to after the procedure has executed. So this is basically a record that consists of all the information about the procedure call that is necessary during execution. Okay, talking about returning, that you then look up in the most recent procedure activation record, because there you will find the control point where to return to, you can of course also do that before the end of the procedure body is reached. And this early exit from the current invocation of a procedure, or from the current call to a procedure, can be done using the return command. To give you a concrete example of that, consider this procedure. Then we have a procedure with the name P again, but now the body is an if. There should be a semicolon here. And then an assignment, and then it's a recursive procedure, so the last command is again a call back to P. Now, whenever it is the case that X is bigger than 10, we can return from the current call. So since P is recursive, you could imagine how this execution happens. Well, let me explain. So suppose we start with, say, the X of value 5, and we call the procedure P. So for each call, we create this activation record, and we store in that activation record the control point where to return to. Okay, and then we enter the body of P by putting the control point at the first command of the body, and we evaluate the if, the test. Well, the test is in this case false, because 5 is not bigger than 10, so we continue with the next command. we increase x to become 6. And we call p again. Now this time, the second call, we again create an activation record in which the control point is stored. And what is the control point? It's the end of our procedure that we are at. So now we have two activation records that is stored on the call stack. And so then you can imagine then entering the procedure p again. Again, we can evaluate the if. X is 6, 6 is not bigger than 10, so X becomes 7, we call P again, that's the third activation record, etc, etc, etc. So then you have the call stack becomes larger and larger and larger. Each time you call P again, a new activation record is added to the call stack, until at some point the test is true, because the value of X is bigger than 10. Well, in that case, we return. And where do we return to? Well, you look at the call stack and the most recent activation record, that is representing the context of the current call, you then look at what is the control point to return to. Well, the control point is to the command that follows the call site from which the procedure was called. Well, and that happens to be the same procedure. But now we pop off the stack, the latest activation record, and we jump to the control point that was recorded in it. Well, then we end up after this call P. And then the body of the P, we run out of commands. So then we also return. So again, we pop from the call stack. And this popping and popping of the call stack happens until at some point we return at the original call site of the procedure P. Now, as you can imagine, that this stack, this call stack, it requires memory. It requires memory where all these control points are stored. Now, if you perform recursive calls too much, then this control, this call stack keeps on growing. At some point, the call stack may outgrow the space that is reserved for it. And if that happens, then a so-called stack overflow happens. There's no longer any room in this stack data structure that keeps track of the control points and the activation records in which the control points are stored. Since there is no space left, typically a program then crashes. So this is then called a stack overflow. Okay, so to give you a nice example of a recursive procedure, I want to give you maybe an interesting problem. And that problem is about, it's a combinatorial problem. It's a question about how many possible strings that consists of open and closing parentheses could you construct with length 2 times n such that the open and closing parentheses all match. So that then all in the string, the open and the closing parentheses are matching. Well, to give you some concrete instances of this problem, consider n is 1. So then how many strings in which matched parentheses are there of length 2? Well, so if n is 1, how many strings of matched parentheses are there of length n times 1, so of length 2? Well, here you see a string of length 2, and it consists of one open parenthesis and one matched closing parenthesis. Okay, so that is the only one, because suppose we started with the closing parenthesis, well, that one doesn't match anything, so that is an invalid string. So consider n is 2. So then of length 4, how many matched parentheses strings are there? Well, there are 2, because we could open a parenthesis and then close it, and then open it again and close it, or we could open it twice and then close it twice. Again, we can't start with the closing parenthesis, because that one doesn't match. And suppose you open and close, then you can also not have a closing one, because that also doesn't match. So these are the only 2 possibilities. And these are the only 2 valid strings of size 4, of length 4, such that all the parentheses in it match. So then when n is 3, you could imagine that these are the valid strings. So meaning that they have matching parentheses. So in this case, this parenthesis matches with that, and the second opening matches the second closing, and the third opening matches the third closing. But you could imagine also having first two open and then two close, and then one open and one close, or you could swap their order, huh? So first open, close, and then open, open, close, close. So these are all the possible valid strings, huh? So strings where the parentheses match. So now the question is, how do you do this for a general N? Well, if you want to solve that puzzle first yourself, well, pause the video and then try to solve the problem, and in the next slide I will give you the solution. So the solution to that problem is not going to explain how to obtain the solution, but the solution to the problem is that there is the so-called Catalan number, which is a sequence of numbers that precisely corresponds to the solution of this problem. And the definition of the Catalan numbers, which is a sequence of numbers, by the way, if you click this link, you will go to the online encyclopedia of integer sequences, a very interesting website where you can find lots of information about sequences of numbers. It gives you this definition. And this is a recursive definition where you could imagine that the sequence C with the index 0, that ranges from 0 all the way up, is defined by giving a base case. So C0 is 1, and we have already seen that because n is 1 gives you one possibility. And then it defines Cn plus 1 in terms of the predecessor value Cn. So indeed, suppose we supply in this n the value 0, then C1 is computed from C0 with this particular term that depends on n. So suppose n is 0, then C1 is 2 times 0 plus 1, so this is 2, divided by 2, which is also 1, so that gives you then 1 times 1, which is 1. So the reason why is that C1 is 1 is because we here have length 2n. Now this is just a weird case, C0, because how many matched parentheses of length 2n are there? If n is 0, then how many matched parentheses of length 0 are there? Well, the empty string, so that is why this is 1. And whenever you have C1, sorry, then you have seen the example here. Yeah. Now, I was confused a bit there. Anyway, if you compute C2, then n is 1. Then you, if you plug in n is 1 here, then you have 2 plus 1 is 3, times 2 is 6, divided by 3 is 2, so that is 2. And that is, of course, the number of parentheses that we have here. So you can check for yourself, indeed, that if n is 2, then C3 becomes, indeed, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so now suppose we want to implement this sequence using a procedure. Here you already see the definition of it. So suppose in a variable x represents the subscript and the variable y represents the output of this sequence, then this procedure, a recursive procedure, because it contains a call to itself, computes this sequence. So you might want to try out for yourself whether you can understand how the execution happens whenever you perform, say, a call to C with, say, X initially being 3 or 4. And you could imagine also how to implement this in a programming language of your favorite, of your choice, your favorite programming language, say. Okay. That's the end of this video. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you soon again.